Okay, so up to last lecture, we have seen some topics from forensic medicine, introduction to forensic medicine, then certain legal terminologies. Then also we have seen courts, different courts in India, summons, inquest, post-mortem appearance or post-mortem examination, all these things we have seen in the last lecture. Now we will just switch on to toxicology today. Today we will see toxicology. So you know there are two parts in our subject, forensic medicine and toxicology. So today we will deal with toxicology. So before going to classification of poison, I will just give you a few points or a few introductory points to toxicology. Now toxicology, the name only tells you, it is the study of poisons. It is the study of poisons. But so many times there is two marks question is asked as toxicology or defined toxicology. So you cannot write like this study of poisons. So the definition should be complete. So definition of toxicology should be complete. That is, it is the study of poison in relation to its physical and chemical properties, its signs and symptoms, its sources, its signs and symptoms, its fatal dose and fatal period, its treatment and its medico-legal importance. So whatever we are going to study in each and every individual poison, as we will go to individual poison, we will study each and every poison in this sequence only. First of all, introduction, its common name, if it is having any specific common name, I will tell you the common name of that particular poison. Then what are its physical properties, or physical or chemical properties. So if it is a chemical, if it is an element, it will have some its own chemical properties as well as some physical properties, whether it is soluble in water, whether it is soluble in alcohol, whether it is, yes, anyone want to say anything? Okay, I will continue. So whether it is volatile, whether it is soluble in water, soluble in alcohol, or and also importantly, route of administration, how it can enter the body and can cause the poisonous effects, that we'll see everything in detail. So when all these things are, then signs and symptoms, then signs and symptoms developed by the poisoning of that particular substance, then what is this fatal dose and fatal period, how much dose should enter the body for its toxicological effects or its signs and symptoms. So what is its fatal dose and fatal period? Then very important is treatment part. What is the treatment of that particular poison? And medico-legal aspect, why we are studying that poison, what is the medico-legal aspect of that poisoning or of that poison. And lastly, importantly, post-mortem appearance. If any person dies by the poisoning by that particular substance, we will see the characteristic post-mortem appearance that will appear on the body. So if any person dies by opium poisoning, what will be the characteristic seen on the dead body, which have been caused by opium, like that. For each and every poison, there will be its characteristic post-mortem appearances will be there. That we will see in detail. So study of poisons in relation to its source, common name, its physical and chemical properties, its signs and symptoms of its poisoning, then fatal dose and fatal period, its treatment, medico-legal aspect, and postmortem. So you have to write everything in detail, because here we are not only studying the poisons, but each and everything that is related with the law and related with our field also. So each and everything that will be taught here, that you are supposed to study here. So we will study the poison in all the aspect. Then another thing that has been explained in the book about the poisons, there is a very very thin margin between medicine and poison. So any substance which is medicine to one person can be a poison to other person. It's very simple. Means if any, I tell you example, any tablet, say any sleeping pill is a medicine for some person, for one person who is not able to sleep, who is having insomnia, who is not able to sleep properly, it will work as a medicine for that person. But the same sleeping pill or sleeping injection is taken by some other person, it can prove poison to him. So the substance can be poison to one person, and the same substance, if it is taken by patient for relieving his some complaints, maybe pain, sleeplessness, or any of his body, or even simple, I call paracetamol, crocin, what we take. It can be a medicine to one person, and it can be a poison to other person. So it is also very, you will have to keep into mind. It is very important. A medicine, a substance can be a medicine to one person, and the same substance can be poison to the other substance. And this is about the individuality. And another thing about the dose, a substance in a proper appropriate dose will act as a medicine. A substance when given or administered to a person in proper adequate dose will act as a medicine, but if its dose is not proper, the same substance will act as poison. So simple thing, again I repeat, sleeping pill, one or two sleeping pills have been taken, they will act as a medicine, they will induce nice sleep, but if they have been taken in large dose, they can kill the person. Same thing with simple crocin or paracetamol. Paracetamol tablet, when taken for relieving the headache or for relieving the body temperature, in proper adequate dose, it will act as a good medicine. It will give relief from the complaint. But if it is taken in large dose, if it is taken in massive dose, it can act as a poison. So these are some of the introductory points. A substance which is medicine for one person can be proved as a poison to other person, and importantly, its dose. That's why I said the first line, there is very, very thin margin or a distinguishing line between a medicine and a poison. Yes, बिल्कुल नहीं, बिल्कुल बिल्कुल नहीं आ रही है। वन सेकंड, माझ्याकडून तर मी अनम्यूट आहे, यू कॅन सी ऑन माय स्क्रीन, आय एम अनम्यूट नाव, फाईन, ओके ओके ओके. यजस्वी, मग कदाचित ती जे कोणी म्हणते ना, तिला आवाज येत नाही, तिचं काही नेटवर्क इश्यू असेल. कोण आहे, कोमल आहे का, कोण आहे? ओके ओके ओके, एव्हरी वन कॅन हिअर मी प्रॉपरली? ओके 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 ओके, आय डोंट नो व्हॉट शी माइट बी हॅव्हिंग सम प्रॉब्लेम विथ नेटवर्क मे बी. ओके, आय विल कंटिन्यू. Where is my screen? Okay. Okay. Got. So this is the way you will have to study toxicology regarding each and everything about the poison. So these are some of the introductory things that you are supposed to know before starting or before going to the going to study the different aspects of toxicology. Okay, so we'll start with the first topic from toxicology, that is classification of poison. Now, there is, I tell you, there is hardly any exam, where the classification of poison is not asked. So very commonly, out of 10 exams, I will say 10 times classification is asked. So each and every paper, university paper, there is always going to be a question on classification of poisons. It can be a separate 5-mark short note in question number 3, or it can be a divided question in the question number 5, 6 or 7. Out of 5, 6 or 7, you will have to write one long question. So in that, all these three questions are from toxicology. One question is from general toxicology, and another two are from individual poison. And the question from general toxicology generally contains classification of poison. Means many times it contains the classification of poison. So we will start with classification of poison. So no classification of poison is satisfactory, and it is very important. No classification of poisons is satisfactory because many poisons come under more than one group. So it is not like that this poison is only cardiac, or this poison is only you can say cerebral, because it will, if I give you an example, if I say any poison as a cerebral poison,
it will not have action only on the cerebrum, but it will also have the action on other parts of the body. That's why no classification of the poison is satisfactory, as so many poisons come under more than one group. So it will be difficult for classification. It will be difficult for classification. So we will see the most satisfactory classification. We will see the most satisfactory classification which has been accepted. I will just go one by one. First important group of the poisons is corrosives. As you can see, the first important group of the poisons is corrosives. The name only tells you which cause corrosion, burning, ulceration and all. Whenever strong acid, I give you directly the example, whenever any strong acid falls on the screen skin, what will happen? It will burn, it will cause ulceration, destruction of the skin. So it will cause severe corrosions, burning, destruction and all. So corrosives are highly active irritants. They will cause ulceration of the tissue, and all the strong acids and strong alkalis will fall in this group. Strong acids and strong alkalis. I have mentioned a few examples. Again, these strong acids are again classified into mineral, organic and vegetable acids. Mineral acids, you might have heard this term so many times in your school or junior college level, in chemistry laboratory, as well as in your physiology pathology lab, because many of these poisons are used for so many chemical tests in the physiology pathology labs. So the mineral acids, examples of mineral acids are sulfuric, nitric and hydrochloric acid. Sulfuric acid H2SO4, nitric acid HNO3 and hydrochloric acid HCl. HNO3, HCl, H2SO4, these are the commonly used mineral acids in laboratory. So these acids are, when they are strong, these strong acids are corrosives. They are corrosive in nature. They all are mineral. The second group of corrosive acids is organic acids. Organic acids are oxalic, carbolic, acetic and salicylic acids. These are, you might have heard these names of these acids in your laboratory also. So organic acids are oxalic, carbolic, acetic and salicylic acid. These are the poisons which will be there in your syllabus. Then third is vegetable acid. There is only one vegetable acid there in your syllabus, is hydrocyanic acid. And the salts of the hydrocyanic acid are called as cyanides, sodium cyanide, potassium cyanide, which are very deadly poisons, which are very dangerous poisons. Then another example of corrosives is concentrated alkalis. So two groups, you got the two groups, acids, strong acids and strong alkalis. Strong acids are again divided into mineral acids, organic acids and vegetable acids, and concentrated alkalis like caustic soda, caustic potash, carbonates of ammonia, sodium and potassium. These are some examples of concentrated alkalis: sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, carbonates of ammonia, that is ammonium carbonate, sodium carbonate and potassium carbonate. All these are the alkalis which are considered to be corrosive in nature. Again, I repeat, they should be in concentrated form. When they are diluted by adding the water, they will become irritants. They will become irritant acid, because they will not cause that much corrosion when they are strong undiluted with the water. So corrosives are strong acids and strong alkalis. Strong acids are again divided into mineral acids, organic acid and vegetable acids, and concentrated alkalis is the second class of corrosives. Now, second very important and very big from our syllabus point of view, from our study point of view, this irritants group is the biggest one. So many of the poisons will fall under this irritant group. So irritants group, these medicine poisons will contain all the corrosives when they are diluted. The corrosives when they are diluted will act as irritant, and they will cause abdominal pain, vomiting and purging. This is their action on the gastrointestinal tract. When they are swallowed, when they are taken by the mouth, they will act as irritant and will cause abdominal pain, vomiting and purging. Now the irritants are further classified into organic and inorganic. Irritants are further subdivided into inorganic irritants and organic irritants. Inorganic irritants are further divided into
नॉन मेटल्स एंड मेटल्स. यस, इनऑर्गेनिक मेटल्स आर फर्दर डिवाइडेड इंटू नॉन मेटल्स एंड मेटल्स. नाउ यू कैन मेंशन व्हेन देर विल बी अ क्वेश्चन ऑन क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ द पॉइजन्स, यू विल हैव टू गिव द एग्जाम्पल्स, एग्जाम्पल्स इन फ्रंट ऑफ एवरी, एटलीस्ट वन आर टू एग्जाम्पल्स इन फ्रंट ऑफ एवरी टाइप. सो नॉन मेटल्स आर फॉस्फोरस, क्लोरीन, ब्रोमीन, आयोडीन, बोरॉन. वॉट इज क्लोरीन, ब्रोमीन, आयोडीन? दे आर हेलोजन्स, दे आर हेलोजन्स. फॉस्फोरस इज ऑल्सो नॉन मेटल. फॉस्फोरस, क्लोरीन, ब्रोमीन, आयोडीन, बोरॉन, दीज आर सम ऑफ द नॉन मेटेलिक पॉइजन. एंड मेटेलिक पॉइजन, देर आर सो मेनी मेटेलिक पॉइजन्स आर देर इन आर सिलेबस, इन आर बुक ऑल्सो. सो इम्पॉर्टेंट आर आर्सेनिक, आर्सेनिक, एंटीमनी, मर्क्यूरी, मर्क्यूरी पॉइजनिंग अगेन वेरी कॉमन एंड वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. लीड पॉइजनिंग, यू विल सी मेनी केसेस ऑफ लीड पॉइजन, दे आर जनरली आस्क एज ए 20 मार्क लॉन्ग क्वेश्चन. आर्सेनिक पॉइजनिंग, लीड पॉइजनिंग आस्क एज ए 20 मार्क लॉन्ग क्वेश्चन. देन कॉपर, थैलियम, जिंक, मैग्नीशियम, मैंगनीज, सो मेनी आर देयर. एंड अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट मेटल इज रेडियो एक्टिव सब्सटेंसेज विच इमिट द रेडिएशन, विच इमिट द रेडियो एक्टिविटी. सो दे आर कॉल्ड एज रेडियो एक्टिव सब्सटेंसेज. इट इज आस्क एज अ सेपरेट 5 मार्क शॉर्ट नोट. सो रेडियो एक्टिव सब्सटेंसेज आर ऑल्सो अंडर मेटल्स. नाउ सेकंड ग्रुप ऑफ इरिटेंट पॉइजन्स, सेकंड सब ग्रुप ऑफ इरिटेंट पॉइजन इज ऑर्गेनिक. सो वी हैव सीन फर्स्ट इनऑर्गेनिक. इनऑर्गेनिक्स आर नॉन मेटल्स एंड मेटल्स. एंड ऑर्गेनिक्स आर वेजिटेबल्स, एनिमल एंड मैकेनिकल. वेजिटेबल, एनिमल एंड मैकेनिकल. सो वेजिटेबल पॉइजन्स, अगेन सो मेनी हंड्रेड्स ऑफ वेजिटेबल पॉइजन्स आर देयर. सो मेनी आर देयर इन यूर सिलेबस ऑल्सो. यू विल हैव टू स्टडी देम इंडिविजुअली. कैस्टर ऑयल सीड्स, एब्रस प्रिकेटोरियस, कोलोसिन. एब्रस प्रिकेटोरियस इज आस्क एज अ 5 मार्क शॉर्ट नोट. अर्गॉट पॉइजनिंग इज आस्क एज अ 5 मार्क शॉर्ट नोट. मार्किंग नट, मदा, सो मेनी आर देर. आई हैव जस्ट मेंशन अ फ्यू. आई हैव मेंशन हार्डली 6-7, वेरी फ्यू नंबर्स आई हैव मेंशन. देर आर सो मेनी वेजिटेबल पॉइजन्स आर देर. देर इज डिजिटलीज, देर इज ओलियंडर, सो मेनी. देन सेकेंड ग्रुप, सब ग्रुप ऑफ ऑर्गेनिक पॉइजन्स इज एनिमल्स. द पॉइजन्स फ्रॉम द एनिमल किंगडम, दैट इज कैंथराइड्स, कैंथराइड्स, स्नेक पॉइजन, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. यस यस यस, कैंथराइड्स, देन स्नेक पॉइजन, देन स्कॉर्पियन बाइट. स्कॉर्पियन बाइट एंड स्पाइडर्स, स्पाइडर्स आर ऑल्सो, देर आर सो मेनी डेंजरस स्पाइडर्स आर ऑल्सो देयर ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड. इन सर्टन लोकेलिटीज सो मेनी डेंजरस स्पाइडर्स आर देयर, देयर बाइट कैन इवन किल द पर्सन. सो दैट दे हैव ऑल्सो बीन इंक्लूडेड इन एनिमल पॉइजन. Nikita, Gajanan, mute yourself. Sakshi, mute yourself. मीटिंग जो 40 मिनटासाठी असते ना, एवढे लवकर का संपली बरं? 15 मिनटातच, 15 मिनटातच का संपली मीटिंग? अरे काय रे तुम्ही, मी 3 चा टायमिंग दिलं तुम्हाला. पण मी चालू केल्याशिवाय चालू नाही होणार ना मीटिंग. मी 3:02 चालू केली मीटिंग. नाही मी डायरेक्ट ॲड करतो आता ते परमिशनमध्ये. मला परत मागे जाऊन प्रत्येकाला ॲड करत बसायला लागतं ना, त्यामुळे मी ते डायरेक्ट अलाव केलेलं आहे सेटिंगमध्ये जाऊन. हां ओके, यू कॅन सी द स्क्रीन, एव्हरी वन कॅन सी द स्क्रीन. ओके, वी विल सी द क्लासिफिकेशन फर्दर, कंटिन्यू विथ द क्लासिफिकेशन. सो
we have seen first corrosives. Corrosives are acids and concentrated acids and concentrated alkalis. Concentrated acids are mineral, organic and vegetable. Then irritants are inorganic and organic. Inorganic we have seen non-metals and metals. Then organic. Organic are vegetable, animal and mechanical. So vegetable poisons, so many are there. I mentioned a few names there. Then animals, cantharides, snakes, different types of snakes like neurotoxic and vasculotoxic, so many sea snake and all, scorpion and spiders. Then mechanical. Mechanical poisons means only their mechanical presence will cause pathological or poisonous effect, like powdered glass. When the powdered glass will enter the mouth, through the mouth, esophagus and stomach, it will cause erosions on the esophageal mucosa, it will cause erosion on the gastric mucosa, and there will be trauma to the wall of the intestine. That is powdered glass. Then chopped hair, dried sponge and diamond dust. You know, diamond is also deadly poison. कोणाचं माईक चालू आहे? प्लीज म्यूट म्यूट म्यूट. घरातल्या सगळ्या गप्पा चालू आहेत, मला ऐकू येत आहेत. म्यूट करा रे सगळे. कोणाचा माईक चालू आहे? गॉट द टू ग्रुप्स ऑफ द पॉइजन्स, करोजिव्स अँड इरिटंट्स. इरिटंट्स inorganic, non-metals, metals, and organic, vegetable, animal, and mechanical poisons. Now we will see the third group of poisons. Third group of poisons is neurotics. They will have, the name only tells you, the neurotics will have action on nervous system. It will have action on the nervous system. And again, these neurotics are classified into cerebral, spinal and peripheral. So cerebral means these cerebral poisons will have their action on cerebral cortex, on the cerebrum. Spinal will have their action on the spinal cord, and peripheral poisons will have action on the peripheral nerves. So cerebral poisons are again classified into three subgroups. Under neurotics, cerebrals are again classified into three subgroups: somniferous, which induce the sleep, somniferous, which induce the sleep, that is opium and its alkaloids. Opium and all its alkaloids will come under somniferous. Inebriant, this group of poison. Inebriants, the commonest inebriant poison is alcohol. Then anesthetics, you know, anesthetic can also be very dangerous if they are given in adequate dose for performing any surgery. We have to anesthetize the patient. So when such an anesthetic is used as a for giving the anesthesia in adequate dose, we can conduct the surgery very nicely. But if that anesthetic is used in very large dose, the large dose of anesthetic drug has been given, it can kill the patient. So anesthetics like ether, chloroform, and nowadays so many injections are also there, which are given for anesthesia purpose. Now there are different grades of anesthetic: ultra short acting, short acting, long acting, like this. So depending upon how much anesthesia you require, 5-10 minutes small surgery, 1 hour surgery, 3 hour surgery. So depending upon the surgery, what accordingly we go for the anesthetic. So if it has been given in adequate dose, it will be okay. But if it is given in large dose, it can cause death of the patient because of anesthesia. Then sedatives and hypnotics. Example is barbiturates, zopecha goya, barbiturates. Then fuels like kerosene, petrol, so many. Kerosene is also poisonous when it is swallowed. So many clinical features will be there. Insecticides. Insecticides mean the things which we use for killing the insects. Jo kheti mein wagera istemal kiye jate hai bahut sari dawaiya, what we call it as insecticides and pesticides. These insecticides are also very dangerous. You might have heard, you might be reading for so many years, the farmers are committing suicide and also so many times they either go for hanging or for by soiling these insecticides. So commonest used insecticide is organophosphorus. So this organophosphorus, also called as OPP, organophosphorus compounds, are commonly used for suicidal purpose. We will study organophosphorus in detail. So in cerebral poisons, somniferous, example is opium. Inebriant is alcohol. Anesthetic is ether and chloroform. Sedatives and hypnotics, good example is barbiturates. fuels are kerosene, petrol, so many. Insecticides are organophosphorus. And third group of the cerebral poison is deliriant. So they will act on the central nervous system, they will act on the cerebrum and so many higher centers and will cause delirium. You know what is delirium? So they will cause deliriant action. They will depress the higher centers and there will be deliriant condition. Like very good examples are Datura, Belladonna, Hyoscyamus, cannabis and cocaine. These are the very common delirium poisons, and these are also very commonly asked as a 5-mark short note. Datura, Hyoscyamus, cannabis indica, cannabis sativa and cocaine. These are the delirium. So in neurotics, first group of poison is cerebral, which has again been divided into somniferous, inebriants and delirium. Then second subgroup of neurotics is spinal poison. The name only tells you all these spinal poisons will have their action on where? On the spinal cord. They will have their action on the spinal cord. Two very good examples of spinal poisons are Nux vomica and Gelsemium. Nux vomica is very commonly asked as a long question. Nux vomica is a spinal poison. You might have heard the name Nux vomica in your pharmacy as well as in first year as well as in the Matra Medica. So it is very good homeopathic medicine also. These names you might have heard: Belladonna, Hyoscyamus, Cannabis Indica. All these are the homeopathic medicine. Means from all these poisonous substances, homeopathic medicines are also prepared. Nux vomica is a spinal poison. And third group of neurotics is peripheral poison. Peripheral poison is curare or conium. Curare and conium, these are the two examples of peripheral nerve poisons which act on the peripheral nervous system. Now, fourth group of poisons is cardiac. The name only tells you the poisons or the substances which are having their effect on heart muscle or on the cardiac activity. They are cardiac poisons. Examples from your syllabus are digitalis, aconite, oleander, conium, tobacco is also there, tobacco. So digitalis, again, it is a very good homeopathic medicine prepared from digitalis. Aconite, you know, it is a very good homeopathic medicine, oleander and conium as well. So this is the example of cardiac poisons. Then next is asphyxiants. The name only explains you what is asphyxia. Any disturbance in the respiration, where oxygenation of the blood will be hampered. These poisons will mainly have their action on the respiratory system. These asphyxiant poisons will have their main action on the respiratory system. That's why patient will have difficulty in breathing, inadequate oxygenation of the blood, and so many complications will take, the hypoxia, anoxia and all. So examples of asphyxiant poisons are coal gas, carbon monoxide, that is commonly asked in exam, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide poisoning, sewer gas, war gases. War gas is again very common asphyxiant poison that is mainly seen at the war places. And other poisons which are not having their specific action on any one part or any one system of the body, they all have been grouped into miscellaneous poisons because of the widely different action. So they will have action on different parts, different organs of the body at the same time. That's why they have been grouped, because no any specific group or any organ or any part of the body that is targeted by these poisons, they are having multi-system or they are having action on different organs, different parts of the body. That's why they have been grouped into miscellaneous. And all these are the allopathic medicine. The name, all these names will suggest you. Analgesics, antihistaminics we use for allergy purpose, analgesics to relieve the pain, antidepressants which are used in the psychiatry, then stimulants like amphetamines and hallucinogens. All these are the medicines which are used in allopathy, but they can have their poisonous effect if not used rationally or adequately. So this is the group of the poisons where no any specific organ or part of the body is affected by this. So I will just revise in short the poisons. There is no any classification of poison that is satisfactory, because many poisons fall in more than one group. corrosives which are having the destructive action on any part, mucosa, skin, or whatever part that will come in contact with these poisons. When they are strong, they are mineral acids, organic acids, and vegetable acids, and alkalis are concentrated acids. So strong acids are of three types: minerals, sulfuric, nitric, hydrochloric; organic, oxalic, carbolic, acetic, salicylic; vegetable acid, one vegetable acid from sea level, hydrocyanic acid; and concentrated alkalis, sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, and ammonium sodium or potassium carbonate. Irritants are classified into inorganic. Inorganic again subclassified into non-metals and metals. Irritants, second subgroup of irritants is organic. Organic are again classified into vegetable, animal, and mechanical. I have mentioned the examples. And third group of poisons is neurotics, which are having their main action on the nervous system. Then neurotics are again classified into depending upon their action, their target part. That is cerebrum. If they are acting on the cerebrum, they are cerebral poisons, again subclassified into somniferous, inebriants, and deliriant. And second group of neurotics is spinal, having their action on the spinal cord, and peripheral, having their action on the peripheral nerves. Cardiac, they will have their action on the heart. Asphyxiants will have their action on the respiratory tract, causing difficulty in breathing, and oxygenation of the blood will be hampered in the lungs. Then miscellaneous, widely different action on the allopathic medicines. Now, after studying the classification, of the poison, what we are supposed to know, how that poison will enter our body. After studying the poison, how that poison will enter our body, that's why the second topic from toxicology will be routes of administration. How, I will just teach you systemically, means we have studied the classification. Now we will see the entry of that poison into the body, how that poison can get entry into the body, what are the different routes of administration. Then after entering the body, what will happen? Action of the poison. So our next topic will be action of the poison, like this. So we will go just sequentially point, so that it will be easy for you to remember and to understand also. So routes of administration. First is enteral. Enteral, that is anything related with the gastrointestinal tract. You know, enteritis means inflammation of the small intestine. That is called as enteritis. So enteral means entry into the gastrointestinal tract. So poison, poison can be taken either through mouth, or it can also be introduced through the rectum. So it can be taken orally or through the rectum. Ultimately, it is going to enter the gastrointestinal tract, and this poisonous substance will be absorbed across the gastrointestinal tract mucosa. So enteral means they will enter the gastrointestinal tract either through swallowing, through the mouth, or through the rectum. Some of the poison can be inserted through the rectum. Then second route of administration, second way of entering the poison into the body, is parenteral, paraenteral, that is parenteral, other than gastrointestinal tract, other than gastrointestinal tract. So it can be in the form of injections. It can be in the form of injections like subcutaneous injection into the skin, subcutaneous injection below the skin. Then intramuscular, intravenous, you might have heard this name, intramuscular injection, that is given either in the tricep or in the gluteus maximus muscle. And in case of children, on the lateral aspect of the thigh, you know, there are different ways of giving intramuscular injection. Intravenous, injecting into the vein, it can be in the intravenous route. Intra-arterial, some of the injections or some of the poisons can be directly injected into the artery. Intraperitoneal, some poisons can be injected into the peritoneum through the abdomen, it can through the abdominal wall, it can be introduced directly into the peritoneal cavity. And bone marrow, again very common, bone marrow, bone marrow, that is the least common, that is the least, bone marrow mein direct kuni injection det nahi, direct kuni poison deu shakat nahi, it is very difficult to introduce. So common methods of administering or consuming or taking the poison in the body is swallowing, that is enteral. Least less common than is parenteral, either subcutaneous, intramuscular or intravenous injection, or intraarterial, less commonly intraperitoneal, and least commonly into the bone marrow. route of administration of the poison is inhalation. The poison can enter the body through inhalation, that is through the respiratory tract. Now again I will go back to the classification. See, fifth point, asphyxiant. How the asphyxiant poisons will enter the body? Through the respiratory tract, through inhalation. So asphyxiant poisons, irrespirable gases, carbon monoxide, sewer gas, war gas and all these dangerous gases, these dangerous gases will enter the body ultimately through the respiratory tract. So that is the another way of entry of poison into the body is inhalation. Another route of entry is external application on wounds or on the interskin. So either on the broken skin, that is wounds, any poison can be injected locally or it can be inserted locally into the open wound or even by rubbing on the healthy skin, because skin can also absorb the so many poisons. So external application on the wounds or on the intact skin, and the poison will be absorbed through the open wound. Maybe damaged capillaries and damaged vessels will absorb the poison, or in case of intact skin, the skin itself, even though it is unbroken healthy skin, can also absorb some poison. That we'll see when we discuss the individual poisons, which poison can be absorbed through the intact skin. Then another route of entry is introduction into natural orifices. Some of the poisons can be introduced into natural orifices like rectum, vagina, urethra, eyes. Some of the poisons can be introduced into the eyes or even into the nose. Through the nose, they can be given in the form of drops or powder like that. So introduction into natural orifices other than gastrointestinal tract, other than injection. And last is sublingual. Sublingual means below the tongue. You might have heard or seen some patient take their tablet below the tongue. मतलब कुछ कुछ दवाई की गोलियाँ ऐसी रहती है कि जो डॉक्टर लोग बोलते हैं कि जबान के नीचे रखो, बिकॉज देर इज वेरी रैपिड एब्सॉर्प्शन थ्रू दैट सबलिंगुअल प्लेक्सेसेस. सो सम पॉइजन्स कैन ऑल्सो बी गिवन सबलिंगुअली व्हेन दे आर केप्ट बिलो द टंग. दे विल बी रैपिडली एब्सॉर्ब, विल सर्कुलेट रैपिडली एंड विल गिव देयर इफेक्ट. सो दीज आर सम ऑफ द रूट्स ऑफ एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ द पॉइजन. एंटेरल इन टू द गैस्ट्रोइंटेस्टाइनल ट्रैक्ट, parenteral, all the ways of the injection, inhalation into through the respiratory tract, external application on wounds or on the intact skin, or introduction into natural orifices like rectum, vagina, urethra, eyes, anywhere, and sublingual below the tongue. Now once the poison, we have seen the classification, we have seen different ways of entry of poison into the body. We have seen different ways or different routes of entry of poison into the body. Now after entry of poison into the body, what will happen? The poison will start manifesting its or start showing its action. So we'll see action of the poison. Action of the poison is asked as a 5-mark short note. So what is action of the poison? So action can be local or remote, or both local and remote. And fourth one is general, that we'll see. So local poisons or local action. Local poison means the poison will act on the part that is coming in contact with directly. Very common example I just told you in the classification, corrosives. When the corrosive will fall on the body, if any say concentrated sulfuric or concentrated nitric acid falls on your skin, whatever the local damage will occur on your skin, or simple, I give you example, if it has been swallowed, accidentally anyone has swallowed that sulfuric, concentrated sulfuric or nitric acid has entered the mouth, what will happen? It will cause severe burning, ulceration and destruction and corrosion of the tongue, throat and esophagus. That is local action, because that mucosa and that part of the body has come in direct contact with the corrosive acid. That's why there is ulceration and destruction, because of the local action of the poison. Then irritants when some of the irritant poisons will enter your gastrointestinal tract, before their absorption systemically going into the liver and circulating through the systemic circulation, they will cause their local irritative action on the stomach, on the gastric mucosa. Common example I give, lead. when the lead is swallowed, when the lead is swallowed, when it will enter the stomach, because of its local action on the stomach or gastric mucosa, it will cause local symptoms like gastritis, severe pain in the abdomen and all. And after it absorption, it will cause remote action, that we will see second. So you are getting. So the local action manifested by the poisons when they are in direct contact with the tissue or part of the body. Corrosives will cause destruction. Irritation and inflammation will be caused by some of the irritants. Again, very common example, a very good example is arsenic. Arsenic when will be swallowed, when the arsenic is swallowed, when it is taken orally, on reaching the stomach, it will cause severe burning pain in the stomach and irritation, even vomiting and all. So that is the local action of arsenic on gastric mucosa. Third is nervous action. Nervous action, the poison will locally cause stimulation of the nerves. Again, very good example is atropine. Atropine drops, when the atropine drops are put into the eye, they will cause dilatation of the pupil. The pupils will get dilated because of the action of the atropine. That is only a local action, not through the brain and all. So it will just locally cause dilatation of the pupil. Then, got what is local action? So local action is because of the direct contact of poison with the particular part or any organ or any part of the body. And it will locally just irritate, either the corrosives will cause corrosion, irritants will cause irritative action like severe pain, vomiting, inflammation and all. I'm talking of GIT. Then second type of action is remote action, means the poison has been absorbed. I repeat the same example, lead or arsenic. I can give any of the example. In case of lead or arsenic poison, because of its local action on the stomach, there is pain in the abdomen, vomiting, burning and all. But now, that is because of local action. But now, the poison has been absorbed across the gastrointestinal tract mucosa. The poison has been absorbed across the gastrointestinal tract mucosa. It has reached the liver and circulated all over the body. So, lead will act on the nerves. Lead will act on the muscles. Arsenic will act on the brain. Arsenic will act on so many other parts like kidney and all. So, this is local action. So after the absorption of the poison, it will get deposited. Now it will depend upon the mechanism of action of that poison. It can be cerebral, it can be cardiac, it can be nervous, neurotic, like this. So depending upon the nature or type of the poison, its toxic effects will depend. I have mentioned below that is specific and non-specific. So remote action will depend upon the nature of the poison. If it is opium or alkaloid, it will act on cerebrum. So its specific remote action will be on cerebrum. If it is strychnine is active principle of Nuxvomica. Strychnine is Nuxvomica poison. Nuxvomica poison, we have seen in the classification, it is a spinal poison. So it will act on the spinal cord and accordingly clinical features will be developed. Curare will act on the motor nerve endings. It will act on the motor nerve endings, causing peripheral nerve manifestations. Digitalis, if it has been taken orally, it will be absorbed across the gastrointestinal tract mucosa and through the blood it will go to the heart and it will have cardiac manifestation. So that is that remote action. That is specific depending upon the type of the poison. Same thing, liver can be affected by so many poisons, because you know the normal anatomy and physiology. Whatever we have swallowed, whatever we have pushed into our gastrointestinal tract, it will be absorbed from stomach, duodenum, small intestine and all, and everything will be carried from the gastrointestinal tract through portal circulation to liver. So liver will try to detoxicate it. So whatever poison we have swallowed, it will be carried to the liver via portal circulation, and in attempt to perform detoxication of that particular substance, what will happen? Liver will be affected and there can be pathological changes in the liver itself. And kidney, so many poisons, while after circulating into the body, they will be ultimately carried for excretion to the kidney. So while passing that poison, while passing through the kidney, what will happen? It will cause pathological effects in the kidney as well. So it can damage the kidney while passing through the kidney for excretion. So remote action will depend, remote action is a action after absorption of the poison and when it will circulate in the body. It can be specific depending upon its type, or it can be non-specific like shock, means it will not affect any one part. Remote action will not affect any one part of the body, it will affect many parts at a time, many parts, many systems at a time. Corrosives. If any patient, just I had given an example, if any patient has accidentally swallowed those concentrated sulfuric acid, it will cause local effect on the mouth, throat, pharynx, esophagus, and stomach. It will cause destruction and ulceration of gastrointestinal tract. But also because of that severe pain and dehydration and all, patient will go into shock. So that is the non-specific remote action of the poison. Then local and remote. Some poisons are having local as well as remote action. I have already given you an example, arsenic. Arsenic is having local action on the stomach as well as remote action after its absorption. Lead. Lead is having local action on the stomach, irritation, vomiting, severe pain, and after absorption it will have effect on the distant organs. So same thing, local and remote. This one poison is having local as well as remote action. And another important action is general. General means more than one system, many systems are affected. Like arsenic, I have given an example, arsenic, mercury, so kidney will be affected, brain will be affected, muscles will be affected, liver will be affected. So by the one poison, as it will be distributed all over the body, as we have seen in the this classification in specific, opium will act only on the cerebrum. It will not cause any damage to the other organs. Digitalis will act on the heart only, like this. But here there are certain poisons which will affect more than one organ or more than one system, what we call it as multi-system failure. So patient will have renal failure, patient will have cardiac problem, patient will have nervous system poisoning effects on nervous system also. In mercury also there are so many general symptoms are there where more than one system are involved. So this is about action of the poison. I think we should stop here. The next topic is factors modifying action of the poison. It is a big topic. It is a bit bigger topic. Okay, so today we have seen classification of the poison. Classification of the poison, then routes of entry or routes of administration of the poison, and very important is action of the poison. Got everyone? I hope everyone has understood. You are getting any problem? Again, I am asking, any problem with speed, any problem with my way of explanation, my way of teaching? Everyone is comfortable? Okay. What you are doing after attending, because you don't have books, no, I suppose you don't have books with you. So what you do, not only about my lectures, I'm asking for all the lectures, after listening the lectures, how do you study after attending the lectures? How do you prepare the notes and all? Achha, Parat Bhakta tumhi YouTuber. हाँ मी माझे माझे हाँ माझे काही व्हिडिओज आहेत, पण आत्ता आत्ता हे मी जे नवीन बॅचसाठी जे चालू केले आहेत फ्रॉम इंट्रोडक्शन टू फॉरेन्सिक मेडिसिन, ते काय अजून मी पोस्ट केलेले नाहीत. आय विल पोस्ट वन बाय वन, आय विल पोस्ट ऑल दिस, अँड आय थिंक माय नोट्स आर देअर. आय हॅव शेअर्ड द नोट्स ऑफ फॉरेन्सिक मेडिसिन अँड नोट्स ऑन नोट्स ऑफ टॉक्सिकॉलॉजी इन युअर ग्रुप, नो, सो यू कॅन फॉलो दोज पीपीटीज आय हॅव शेअर्ड इन युअर ग्रुप. केलेन, अरे फॉरेन्सिक मेडिसिन अँड टॉक्सिकॉलॉजीचे नोट्स मी तुमच्या ग्रुपवर शेअर केल्यात. ह्या ज्या पीपीटीवरून मी तुम्हाला शिकवतो त्या सगळ्या शेअर केल्यात ना मी ग्रुपवर मागच्या आठवड्यातच. पीपीटी 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 शेअर केल्यात मी. ओके ओके, व्हॉट आय विल डू, आय विल शेअर दीज नोट्स फ्रॉम विच आय एम टीचिंग यू. यू आर गेटिंग द पीपीटीज फ्रॉम विच आय एम टीचिंग यू. आय विल शेअर दीज ऑन युअर ग्रुप, सो दॅट इन विच ग्रुप यू आर, समर ऑर विंटर? समर, समर 21. ओके ओके, आय विल शेअर बोथ फॉरेन्सिक अँड टॉक्सिकॉलॉजी टू द ग्रुप, सो दॅट इट विल बी इझी फॉर यू टू रीड रिपीटेडली अँड इट विल बी इझी फॉर यू टू अंडरस्टँड. ओके देन.